This is a community-supported legal education channel. Find out how you can support our mission at the links in the description below.
So there is an update in the Christopher Hook situation. This is Alan Baker v. Allstate Insurance Company. This is the one where Hook wrote to the insurance company with all sorts of very inappropriate things to say. We'll put up a little bit of a screenshot here. We have a redacted copy, but he called them all sorts of names. He cursed at them. He even said he knew where they lived and knew the guy's wife, and it made them really uncomfortable and maybe even a little fearful that someone who's off the hook might do something violent or otherwise more than just words. And Judge Otis Wright of the Central District of California had absolutely zero patience for all of this. And you heard him tear into Hook in a oral argument or contempt or sanctions hearing. And that we have that video, so go check that out in the bubble that we just popped up on the screen. But here is the end, maybe the end of the attorney's fees award, because a new law firm had to be brought in to replace Christopher Hook, and the plaintiffs who were suing their insurance company had to pay for those attorneys. They had to get a new settlement worked out because Hook hadn't worked out the settlement. And now those Allstate attorneys, those insurance companies' attorneys, are asking for their fees and costs. If you remember, they had asked for $40,000 in fees and costs, and attorney Hook had protested that, had hired his own attorneys, I believe through his malpractice insurance company, I'm not sure there. He has his own attorneys now, and they wrote a whole thing about how the insurance company's request for fees and costs was excessive. Let's see what Judge Otis Wright has to say about that. This is his order awarding in part, so that already tells us it's going to be limited. They had requested $41,748 in costs and attorney's fees, and he awards them in part. Let's see how much that is. November 26, 2019, Shepard Mullen, on behalf of Allstate, submitted an ex parte application seeking dismissal of the case, disqualification of Hook as plaintiff's counsel, a temporary restraining order against Hook, a protective order preventing depositions, and sanctions in the amount of $6,370. Allstate's counsel, Peter Klee, submitted a declaration indicating that he and Mark Feldman are the only attorneys who prepared the application, and they billed a total of 13 hours. The court then ordered the parties to appear before the court on December 16th and show cause why the court should not levy sanctions against Hook. December 3rd, Hook filed an untimely opposition, and Allstate replied on December 5th. On December 16th, Allstate and its counsel, plaintiffs and their new counsel, and Hook appeared before this court on the issue of whether the court should issue sanctions. During the hearing, the court determined that Hook had acted in bad faith and demanded that Hook pay monetary sanctions. Hook accepted and agreed to pay monetary fees to Allstate for its reasonable costs and fees associated with its application. The court granted monetary fee sanctions against Hook and ordered Allstate to prepare an application for costs and fees up through the hearing date. On December 31st, 2019, Allstate filed its memorandum for costs and attorney's fees in the amount of $41,748, a sharp increase from its initial request of $6,370. The court now determines the amount of sanctions it shall impose. A district court has the primary responsibility for controlling the conduct of the attorneys who practice before it. When an allegation is made that an attorney has violated his moral and ethical responsibility, an important question of professional ethics is raised. It is the duty of the district court to examine the charge, since it is that court which is authorized to supervise the conduct of the members of its bar. The courts, as well as the bar, have a responsibility to maintain public confidence in the legal profession. This means that an attorney admitted to the state bar may be disciplined under the court's inherent power for conduct that violates the state bar's rules of professional conduct, including conduct that occurs outside court. Accordingly, a fee award under the court's inherent power is meant to vindicate judicial authority rather than provide a substantive remedy to an aggrieved party. Nevertheless, a court may impose attorney's fees and costs that are necessary to compensate the innocent party, to vindicate the affront to the court, and to ensure that such abuses are not repeated. Thus, the court may award attorney's fees when the interests of justice so require. Still, the fee award must relate to the bad faith conduct alleged. For an award of monetary sanctions, the court must determine a reasonable hourly rate multiplied by a reasonable number of hours. Generally, in assessing attorney's fees, the court should calculate the lodestar figure by multiplying the number of hours reasonably expended in the litigation by a reasonable hourly rate. After computing the lodestar, the district court may then adjust the figure upward or downward, taking into consideration the 12 reasonableness factors. They are the time and labor required, the novelty and difficulty of questions involved, the skill required to perform the legal service, the preclusion of other employment by the attorney due to the acceptance of the case, the customary fee, whether the fee is fixed or contingent, time limitations imposed by the client or the circumstances, the amount involved and the results obtained, the experience, reputation, and ability of the attorneys, the undesirability of the case, the nature and length of the professional relationship with the client, and awards in similar cases. Accordingly, the court may reduce an attorney's fee award where the documentation is lacking or where the hours billed were excessive, redundant, or otherwise unnecessary or not reasonably expended. On December 16th, the court determined Hook acted in bad faith by sending numerous profanity-laced emails using discriminatory epithets and repeatedly threatening physical violence against Allstate's witnesses, attorneys, and their families, purportedly as negotiation tactics. Accordingly, exercising its inherent powers, the court ruled that Allstate was entitled to costs and attorney's fees for bringing its action. A court may impose attorney's fees that are necessary to compensate the innocent party. At the hearing, Hook also agreed to pay those monetary sanctions. Accordingly, Allstate moves for the $41,748 amount. Hook opposes and requests that the original amount be imposed of $6,370. Shepard Mullen, who represents Allstate, had three attorneys bill on this matter at the following rates: Klee, Feldman, and Burns, all over $400 an hour, a total of 88.8 hours. The lodestar proffered by Shepard Mullen is the near $42,000 figure. When faced with a massive fee application, the district court has the authority to make across-the-board percentage cuts, either in the number of hours claimed or in the final lodestar figure, as a practical means of excluding non-compensable hours from a fee application. When a district court decides that a percentage cut to either the lodestar or the number of hours is warranted, it must set forth a concise but clear explanation of its reasoning. Foremost, Klee's initial representation to this court, made under penalty of perjury, is that Shepard Mullen billed 13 hours to bring the application before this court and requested $6,370 in monetary sanctions. Shepard Mullen now seeks a do-over by asserting that it actually expended 33.2 hours to bring its application. Shepard Mullen says Klee billed 4.6, Feldman 19.3, and Jack Burns 9.3 to bring its application, when it previously asserted that they billed 2 hours and Feldman billed 11 to bring the application, and then Shepard Mullen asserts that Klee billed 1.8 hours as privileged, Feldman billed 0.2 hours as privileged, and Burns billed 1.7 hours as privileged, as in they can't disclose what they billed for. The court denies Shepard Mullen's attempt to backdoor an additional 20.2 hours, which appear punitive, after it represented to the court that it had spent only 13 hours to bring its application, a representation that the court relied upon in granting monetary sanctions to Hook. See the Goodyear Tire and Rubber case, holding that attorney's fees awarded as a sanction for bad faith conduct must be compensatory rather than punitive. Accordingly, the court excludes the additional 20.2 hours. Further, Shepard Mullen's costs and fees records include 4 billing entries that provide no description, stating merely privileged, and amount to 3.7 hours. Without more, the court cannot determine whether the time expenditure is reasonable, and accordingly, the court finds that they are precluded from recovering for those hours. Shepard Mullen also attempts to recover 4.7 billable hours for items that do not necessarily pertain to their application, which include researching plaintiff's new counsel's rights and reviewing media reports. Accordingly, the court finds these hours were unnecessarily incurred. Shepard Mullen asserts that they build 0.6, 3, and 1.1, researching new council rights and media reports. After reviewing Shepard Mullen's costs and fees record, the court finds the hours to be excessive and duplicative. Specifically, Shepard Mullen engaged in block billing. For example, 5 billing entries exceed 4-hour blocks. Additionally, although there are only 3 attorneys billing on this matter, the billing records are riddled with duplicative entries that include reviewing prior filings and case materials. Therefore, the court finds that a 10% reduction for block billing time entries is warranted and an additional 10% for duplicative entries. Lastly, the court imposes an additional 10% haircut reduction to Shepard Mullen's fees. A district court can impose a small reduction no greater than 10% of a haircut based on its exercise of discretion and without a more specific explanation. Accordingly, the court reduces Klee's billable hours to 8.3, Feldman's to 24.9, and Burns to 9.2. Next, the court assesses whether the hourly rates charged by counsel are reasonable. To determine whether these hourly rates are reasonable, courts may consider whether the requested rates are in line with those prevailing in the community for similar services by lawyers of reasonably comparable skill, expertise, and reputation. The relevant community is the district court in which the adjudicating court sits. The party seeking attorney's fees may satisfy its burden of showing that the proposed hourly rate is reasonable by submitting affidavits of counsel or affidavits of other counsel in the relevant community and by providing case law examples to the relevant community rate. Shepard Mullen has provided no evidence addressing prevailing market rates and rate determinations from other lawsuits. Thus, it has failed to establish a satisfactory market for its rates. The burden is on the fee applicant to produce satisfactory evidence in addition to the attorney's own affidavits that the requested rates are in line with those prevailing in the community for similar services by lawyers of reasonably comparable skill, expertise, and reputation. Klee provided no information to establish his and Feldman's hourly rate. The court recognizes the time necessary to prepare filings in this matter, but the application and fee requests are not particularly complex or laborious. For instance, Shepard Mullen billed 17.9 hours for travel time and straightforward research, tasks which do not require great litigation skill. Accordingly, the court finds the rate sought by the attorneys exceeds those merited given the skill required in the present facts. Judges are justified in relying on their own knowledge of customary rates and their experience concerning reasonable and proper fees. Shepard Mullen has failed to justify why partner Klee and Feldman deserve to bill at a higher rate than partner Burns. Accordingly, the court lowers their rates to match partner Burns. So the $420 an hour becomes everybody's rate. Having considered the level of skill and advocacy in the case at issue, the court deems the $420 an hour rate appropriate. Accordingly, the court recalculates the Lodestar award to $17,808. Because the parties do not request a multiplier or reduction factor, the court declines to apply such a factor. Accordingly, the court grants $17,808 in attorney's fees, and that eliminates the costs and fees. Motion so ordered, Judge Otis Wright II, United States District Judge for the Central District of California. So Hook is not quite off the hook yet. He now has to pay $17,808, which I'm assuming he'll either have to pay out of pocket or maybe he has malpractice insurance that covers part of that or something. And we'll see what happens then with any further sanctions or any disciplinary action. He's definitely been referred for disciplinary action after Judge Otis Wright ripped him a new one in December at that December 16th hearing. But the long arm of the disciplinary committee moves slowly. So it will take some time for us to hear about that. He will likely receive, at the very least, some kind of public reprimand, maybe a short-term suspension. I doubt that he will be completely disbarred or receive a suspension longer than 1 year for his misconduct. He did explain, I believe, in one of his filings that he had been dealing with a death in the family and had not reacted well to the mental health situation that created. But beyond that, I don't know anything. So we'll have to wait and see what happens with any disciplinary action. Let us know what you think in the comments below. Certainly, we can all agree that insurance companies have behaved poorly sometimes themselves, and that I can understand why someone would lash out, but attorneys are not supposed to lash out on behalf of their clients with that kind of discriminatory language, etc. And so they're supposed to behave professionally, even when having a disagreement with opposing counsel.
In your experience, is it common for judges to reduce attorneys' fees once they've been submitted?
Yes.
Or is this like is this a weird situation where it's, you know, completely bizarre that the judge would reduce it?
No, I think it's very educational to understand that the judge applies the rules fairly and evenly, or at least they're supposed to, and that even though Attorney Hook really got the ire of Judge Otis right, that doesn't mean the judge is later going to go on and impose everything, you know, throw the book at Hook and then add some cream on the top, some icing on the top. The judge doesn't want to go too far either. The judge wants Hook to receive the natural consequences of his actions, to be disciplined if the disciplinary committee thinks so, but the judge doesn't want to go too far and go outside of the judge's discretion or power. So there's a couple of rules at work here. Those lodestar rules, like you just saw, there's also the rule that an attorney is not allowed to charge an unreasonable fee. So if an attorney represents you and tries to charge you a very, very high, excessive fee, even if you agreed to it, you can probably complain, at least to the judge, maybe even to the disciplinary committee, under the rules about not charging an excessive fee. Now, that fee can still be quite high. Several hundred dollars an hour is not out of the realm of possibility for a single attorney who's experienced and doing complex work. But if you were charged several hundred dollars an hour for the trip to the courthouse, that's not quite the same thing. And so a lot of times attorneys don't charge their full billing rate for travel time to the courthouse because a judge really wouldn't uphold that. Like you saw here, the judge dropped their billing rate, added a 3-10% modifiers down, so maybe 30%, and cut what they are now billing down from $40,000 to $17,808, which at least still represents $11,000 more than the $6,730 that was originally pled for, or $6,370 that was originally asked for. So, yeah, the judge is trying to be fair here and be compensatory, not punitive. And Hook will suffer further consequences from the disciplinary committee. And of course, if he ever gets before Judge Otis Wright, he's going to, you know, judge is already going to be, have one eye on Hook the whole time. So the judge could have dropped it to $6,730, but there were some other consequences from the application and the situation where Shepard Mullen did have to prepare other documents. They did have to attend a court hearing. And so they didn't deserve to get everything under the sun, but they only the reasonable fees from those efforts in the sanctions motion. So what do you think of that? Let us know in the comments below. Do you think Hook has been punished enough, or do you think that still more should happen to him? And what do you think should happen? Should it be a small suspension, just a public reprimand, like a public slap on the wrist? Should it be a year suspension or more? Remember, with a year plus suspension, you have to reapply for reinstatement. And then do you think Christopher Hook should be disbarred? I don't think so, but I'm happy to hear what your opinion is. Let us know in the comments below. So that is our show, everyone. Thank you for joining me. I am Leonard French, your favorite copyright attorney. Thank you to our sponsus.com/law supporters and our patreon.com/LJFrench supporters. This is a community supported channel, and we would not be able to produce this level of content without your help. We currently pay Brandon, Tactical is my assistant, and I pay myself out of the support that you provide and the funds that come from YouTube and Twitch. And without that, that, we just wouldn't be able to work at this level. And so we really appreciate whenever you make your pledge and support our channel financially. Coming up sometime here in 2020, I expect to convert this whole thing into a nonprofit corporation. And when that happens, I will make a big announcement, and your contributions will be tax deductible where applicable, for starters, in the United States. That's not yet, but that's what we're looking forward to. So for now, thank you very much to our $50 plus supporters for the month of March: Wes Delge, Aspernari, Video Remonetized, John Steele, Gavin Barnard, Evie, Kyle Mudrock, Michael Pierce, Spirit Bear, Jan Negre, Daniel Perez, Blackleaf, Joe Tyson, Benjamin Hightoff, Steven, Otta, Cute Grills in Your Area, Longreach Jones, Zachary Cheney, Mullen PC, Jared Bales, and Anders Thorenfeld. And thank you to the $5 plus supporters who will be scrolling on the screen in front of me. These supporters will be in the description of every video that drops on YouTube. I thank you so very much. I'll bring some dogs in here. I love you all. I'm Leonard French, your favorite copyright attorney, and I'll see you in the videos. Bye.
Hit him right in the head. That happens way more often than you would think. He seems to line himself right up, but then kind of forget to grab it out of the air.